Namaste and good afternoon. It's wonderful to be back again with all of you, and it's lovely to see you all at the first of our new Recover series presented by Apollo Hospitals. And this is Dr. Srinidhi Chidambaram here. After infection with COVID-19, the recovery period can be very smooth for some or a bit stormy for others. But it is always a crucial period where the patient needs to pay a lot of attention to the right nutrition, sleep, relaxation, and also be aware of post-COVID complications and how to deal with them. The Recover series brings to you the most important and helpful information for those who have had COVID-19 to recover and regain their health and well-being. We already know that COVID-19 can be severe in people with what we call comorbid conditions like diabetes or heart disease. How do patients who already have cardiac diseases, how should they monitor themselves when they recover from COVID-19? Are they more prone to heart attacks post-COVID? Should people with heart disease continue their medications while they're in hospital, their medications for heart disease, should that be stopped or continued? Should they postpone exercising during the recovery period? And what red alerts should post-COVID patients, both with or without heart disease, be aware of? And above all, how does one deal with post-COVID recovery without feeling unduly anxious, stressed, and frightened about possible cardiac complications? To discuss all this and to discuss and give us the most pertinent tips about post-COVID recovery in patients with heart ailments, and also to talk about COVID-related heart complications and what one must be aware of, we are very happy to welcome Dr. Sai Satish, a senior interventional cardiologist from Apollo Hospitals, Chennai. Dr. Sai Satish is an internationally renowned senior interventional cardiologist with the Apollo Hospitals Group. While he is based out of Chennai, he travels across India and performs procedures at all our hospitals. He's also international director, structural heart at one of the world's best TAVR training centers, the Gottesgen Institute of Cardiology in Budapest, Hungary, a pioneer in the field of transcatheter valve therapies. He holds the reputation for having performed the highest number of percutaneous edge-to-edge mitral repairs in the subcontinent till date. Dr. Sai Satish has also trained several doctors from over 20 countries with his hands-on training program and started the therapy across 30 centers across India, Asia, and Europe. A trailblazer really in minimally invasive cardiovascular therapies, and he has been performing procedures at Apollo Hospital Chennai from 2006 onwards. Welcome, Dr. Sai Satish, and we're very happy to have you here amidst your busy schedule. And I do hope that with your guidance, our viewers will be much assured about cardiac complications and how to deal with them and all the red alerts. Over to you now.
First of all, Srinidhi, thank you so much for such a generous introduction. Almost made me blush. And what makes this afternoon even more special is that it's your birthday. So wish you a very, very happy birthday. And thank you. And thank you for having me here with you today.
Not at all. It's my pleasure.
So before we go into taking some question and answers, I thought I'd take about 5 to 6 minutes to break down how I see COVID from a cardiologist point of view. Okay. And any condition or disease I look at, I like to break it down into three parts. Part number one is how does it affect you? Part number two is how do you cope with it? And part number three is what do you do when you recover from it? Which is pretty much what we are planning to get out to our viewers today.
Absolutely.
So while COVID is a respiratory virus, which predominantly involves the lungs, COVID affects organs by attaching to the ACE receptors. Okay. ACE receptors are 80% in the lungs. So that is why predominantly COVID affects the lungs. But other organs also express ACE receptors, like your pancreas, like your heart, like your intestines. And that is why COVID, over the last 2 years, our understanding of this has grown tremendously. Now, I'm actually quite happy that you put me on the show during the second wave. Because if you had put me up during the first wave, there's so much we didn't know about it. But over the last 2 years that we have lived with COVID, we have understood so much about it. For instance, that is why it's not a disease that affects only the lung, but it affects multiple organs. Because first, majority, 80% affects the lungs. Then it attaches to the other organs, producing symptoms which have lesser ACE receptors, like your heart, your pancreas, your intestines, etc. And not to forget your blood vessels, because that's why you get these blood clots. So how does COVID affect the heart? So now we know that 80% lung involvement, remaining percentages are the organs. How does COVID affect the heart? COVID can affect the heart in two ways, either directly or indirectly. Directly, it affects the heart by infiltrating the heart muscle and producing an inflammation of the heart muscle called myocarditis. Okay. Now, indirectly, it can affect the heart in several ways. Way number one is, suppose there's no cardiac involvement and your lungs are badly damaged. The lungs scar. The heart has to pump blood to the lungs. A scarred lung gives resistance to the pumping of the heart, and thereby the right side of the heart has to struggle more to get blood across to the lungs. So the right side of the heart gets weakened and can fail. COVID patients are a higher tendency to produce blood clots. These blood clots can form in the legs, can form in the brain, can even form directly in the blood vessels supplying the heart. And these can produce heart attacks, or these blood clots can go from the legs and block off blood vessels to the lungs, and thereby produce something called pulmonary embolism, which is quite a serious side effect. So in all these ways, COVID can affect the heart. Now, while I'm talking about all this, I know it sounds really ominous. So it's important to put things in perspective. Okay? We are talking about a very small percentage of people. Now, 80% of COVID positive patients will not require to see a doctor. You will recover spontaneously. 20% will require to see a doctor. In that 20%, another 5%, that is 15%, will go get some treatment, go back home and be fine. 5% will require hospitalization and ICU care. It's not even this 5% that get cardiac involvement. It's 1% and a little less that can have cardiac involvement. So I don't want you all thinking, oh my God, I have COVID. I'm going to drop dead from a heart attack. I'm going to have blood clots. My lungs are going to close off. Absolutely not. The percentage is small. Now, COVID, it's easiest if you wrap your head around COVID like how you would wrap your head around the flu. Okay, we've lived with the flu for over 100 years. That we have researched it intensively since the Spanish flu. You'll be surprised to know that most of Europe got the community health system set up, got a nationalized healthcare program all after they were devastated by the Spanish flu. That's how they developed their healthcare, right? That's how it developed to where it is. So what do we know about the flu? Somewhere between 0.5 and 0.8% get really sick with the flu, right? The problem with COVID is that it's about 5%. So that's about 7 to 8 times that of the normal flu. Now, there are certain zones in the world called blue zones, okay? Like Sardinia in Italy, Okinawa in Japan. And these are blue zones where people effortlessly live to be 100. Now, most people were surprised because these were not just aging 100, they were healthy 100-year-olds driving their bikes, doing grocery shopping, farming. And when they sat down and researched what it took for them to live to be 100, you'd be surprised as to what they found. And I'm not going to go into the details of living to be 100 because this talk is about recovering from COVID. One of the things to be a 100-year-old was to take the flu shot regularly. And the surprising thing is that it was more important than exercising regularly. It's to just take the flu shot. Yeah. Data showed that taking the flu shot. Why? Because in that small percentage of people who get very sick with the flu, the common flu, they have blood clots. And these blood clots can cause strokes and heart attacks. They can die from it. And even if you say 0.5, that is one in every 200 who gets the usual flu, right? And the flu shots prevented that, right? When you look at your vaccination, no? Nowadays, when we are on the topic of blood clots, we can't ignore the topic. We can't speak about the topic of blood clots without talking about vaccination. So when you are in the topic of blood clots, people are talking about certain vaccines having higher incidence of blood clots. But I mean, you're an extremely intelligent, well-informed audience, right? I'm sure I'll learn a thing or two if I spend 15 minutes across any one of you for the amount of information that has been presented to you just about COVID over the last 2 years. You're at home forced to watch only COVID. Don't you agree, Srinidhi? Yeah. 2 years? Okay, sometimes I get such questions. I'm like, wow, I'll have to look it up. So coming back to what I was telling you, do you know what the incidence of clots are in patients who take the COVID vaccine? 5 per million, right? It might be important when you're vaccinating 1 billion people, okay? But it's still 5 per million. Do you know what the incidence of blood clots are when you have a COVID infection? 165,000 per million. Where is 5 per million? Where is 165,000 per million? So it's a no-brainer, right? You'd rather take the vaccine than get COVID. Okay? So we have covered how COVID affects the heart. So it can cause myocarditis, where it directly affects the heart. It can cause blood clot. That can cause pulmonary embolism. It can cause an increase in heart attacks by making blood clots inside the heart. COVID creates an inflammatory response in the body. Now, in the beginning, people didn't understand why these comorbidities, why these people with blood pressure, people with heart disease got sicker. I'll give you a very simple answer. If you have a heart condition, do you have a higher chance of getting heart-related complications from COVID? Yes. If you have a heart condition, are you at more risk from getting sick from COVID? Yes. Why? The percentage is small. Please keep in mind the perspective of the percentage. It's still less than 1%, right? But why? Because people with heart disease tend to be overweight. People with heart disease tend to have diabetes. Now, if you take obesity alone creates more inflammatory markers than not being obese. Now, when you throw COVID in, it exponentially increases. Diabetics alone have a higher chance of blood clots. You throw COVID in, it exponentially increases. So people with heart disease have higher chance of getting COVID-related problems post-recovery. So it can affect the heart by causing myocarditis, heart attacks, pulmonary clots, and by creating abnormal heart rhythms. A second reason why heart patients tend to get sicker is that when you have an infection devastating your whole body, your heart has to work harder to keep you fit. Now, this is hard enough for a healthy heart. Why do you think you get a fever? Why do you think when you get a fever, your heart beats faster? Because it's working harder, right? Now, if you have an ailing heart, it's all the more difficult for it. And as simple as that, it's just common sense. So I think I have summed up that well enough. Would you want me to just continue on about recovery, a short paragraph, Srinidhi, or should we take some questions? And then
there was just one question there that I had. You were just saying about how people with heart disease, if they do get COVID, it is severe. Does it matter which type of heart disease, as in like whether they have a rhythm problem or whether they have a valve issue or whether they have
it's a very vast topic. So it's a very, very good question. But the important thing is that more than the rhythm disturbance, what matters is what the heart function is, whether they are diabetic, whether they've had previous heart attacks. And so, like, for instance, if you take a patient who has had one stent, who has got no diabetes, no hypertension, who exercises well, whose ideal body weight, his chance of sailing out of COVID is almost as good as somebody who's normal. But if you take a 65-year-old who's diabetic for 10 years, who's had a bypass or who's had 3-4 stents, who's already had one heart attack and the heart function is slightly reduced, he's at a higher risk, right? If you take people with high blood pressure, for some reason, they're at a higher risk for getting sicker after COVID, okay? So coming back to one short paragraph about recovery.
Yes.
No two bodies are alike, and the vast majority of you will all recover, okay? Again, a very small percentage, 1%, have cardiac involvement. If you look at what we have learned from global data during the last 2 years of us battling COVID, the cardiovascular-related death has increased globally. Not only has the cardiovascular-related death increased, all-cause death has increased. And this is because of people not seeking help when they normally would when they are sick, rather than directly as an impact of COVID. So if you ask me, cardiac disease has actually gone up, but in hospital, cardiac disease has come down because people are waiting to come to doctors because they're worried about COVID. So it's extremely important COVID or no COVID, that if you have symptoms, you should reach out to your care providers. So that is one. Second thing is immunity. Immunity is not a quick fix, like you wear a garland of garlic and you think you won't be attacked by a vampire. You can't go to the store, take your curcumin, you can't have your zinc supplement and say you're immune. Immunity is discipline, is multifactorial. Immunity is exercise. Did you know that people who work out for 30 minutes, 5 days a week, have a 30% less chance of catching the flu? Did you know that people who are more sedentary have a higher chance of getting seriously ill with COVID? Did you know that people who work out have a 50% more chance of developing antibodies than people who don't regularly work out? Do you know people who drink less have a higher chance of antibody response post-COVID vaccination? So physical fitness is an important part of immunity. Sleep is an important part of immunity. Eating well is an important part of immunity. Right? Smiling, laughing, having a good mental state is an important part of immunity. So immunity is multifactorial. You can't just do one fix and get immune overnight.
Absolutely.
So that's my 10 minutes on COVID, the heart, and preventing COVID. Is there anything? I mean, now I leave it up to you to lead me wherever you wish.
But what about COVID-19 itself? Like, you know, though it can cause heart-related complications, does it worsen the existing heart diseases also?
So COVID can do both. People with existing heart disease, when they get COVID, can get worse. And people who have, like, for instance, people tend to present, like I said, a small percentage of them can present with heart attacks post-COVID. People with heart failure can get worse post-COVID because the body has to deal with the various changes that happen when it has COVID. For instance, low oxygen. For instance, inflammation. It has to deal with the systemic inflammation, right? COVID has two parts. One is the viremia and then the inflammation. So people with ailing and damaged heart can get sicker, even though it's a small percentage. And people without pre-existing heart disease can have cardiac involvement post-COVID. It works both ways.
So you've already discussed about diabetes and hypertension increasing mm-hmm. the risk of COVID itself. Mm-hmm. Does it also have an increased risk of people who get COVID with diabetes and hypertension? Are they more prone to develop heart-related complications? Either you already spoke about the clots, but even heart attacks or any other myocarditis, any of that?
We don't. Okay. So this myocarditis is a elusive beast. The reason is we know that any viral fever, violent toxic viral fever can produce cardiomyopathy, can produce myocarditis and can suppress heart function. COVID just falls into that group. Okay. Now, while imaging can pick up subtle inflammation of the heart muscle, we don't know what that translates to in outcomes. Definitely, people who are obese and people who have diabetes have a higher chance of developing cardiac-related complications post-COVID infection. Definitely. All right? But its clinical impact on outcomes is yet to be seen.
And also these heart attacks, which we keep hearing of people who came back after recovering from COVID-19 and after a few days developed. What is that all about? I mean, what is exactly going on with them? They developed a heart attack 2 days after they returned, or even a month after they have recovered and started their normal routines. Some say it's even because they started overdoing their exercise. Or what is it all about? How do they get heart attacks?
It's extremely important, which I say this, no matter how often I say it, it doesn't sound cliche to me, because it's extremely important to listen to cues that your body gives you, right? Whatever said and done, COVID is an infection not to be trifled with. Now you've gotten sick. Now, very rarely you will find a story of a person who had asymptomatic COVID and who just dropped dead from a heart attack. They will be people who have had COVID, who have required hospital stay. They've come back home and they've pushed themselves and they end up in trouble. Now, the problem is that even though you require a hospital stay for only 4 to 5 days, the very fact that you needed ICU stay puts you in the bracket that you reacted severely to COVID infection. And the first thing you will notice if you are a COVID patient watching this is that your average heart rate before you had COVID would have changed from after you got COVID. And that's the commonest thing I see in my practice. Patients will say, doctor, my heart rate was always 60, 65. And now I'm 3 weeks into COVID and my heart rate is 90, 95. That is because there is still repair going on in your body. COVID causes inflammation diffusely. Your vasculature has inflammation. So that is why you will find that we look at CRP, which is an indicator of inflammation in the body. And we have found that people with CRPs over 40 are a high-risk bracket. That means they have a more diffuse involvement of vasculature, of the blood vessels, of multi-organs, and they should be more careful in their recovery. They should take it easy. Flat out to all my patients, see, there is nothing you're going to gain by working out 2 weeks early, what you didn't do for the last 20, 30 years of your life, right? So I always say when you recover from, say, a heart attack, or when you recover from a knee injury, or when you recover from COVID, I always say, think of that period of convalescence as an investment you're making for the rest of your life. Take it easy, right? Don't ignore any symptoms. If you feel shortness of breath, you've anyway had COVID, go to hospital, meet your doctor, have yourself checked out. Any patient who has required ICU stay before they go home, in my opinion, should have an echocardiogram. Okay. Is it routine for every COVID patient? Absolutely not. If you've recovered spontaneously and you've had no symptoms, then you listen to your body. For first 2 weeks, do as little as you can. Bed, bathroom, TV, dinner table, just strolling to catch your breath, not for exercise. Okay. From that 2 weeks for another 3 weeks, I only allow walking. Walking is a phenomenal exercise. And the beauty about walking is you can decide your pace depending on how your body guides you, right? I do not recommend any aggressive weight training or aerobic training for at least 1 month post this COVID infection. And then too, I say, start slow. And the way you start slow is your best indicator will be your heart rate. A simple thing to do is do 220 minus age and multiply it by 0.7. Whatever you do, don't push beyond that. 220 minus age into 0.7. When you reach that, maintain, pull back, then pick up pace, pull back, don't push it. And as you get fitter and you realize you're more comfortable, then in a good month, month and a half, you can jump back to your normal routine. And this is patient specific. This depends on how sick you were. This depends on how many days you spent in a hospital. And this depends on whether you had symptomatic or asymptomatic COVID. Now, if you are a patient who had no symptoms at all, some sniffles, a mild cold, and you recovered in 3 days without having to take any medication, going to a doctor, 2 weeks later, you can start working out. If you required hospitalization, you have to take it easy.
What about children? Because in this wave, and even if at all we get a third wave, there's this talk that children are more affected. Do they also, I mean, we know that most of them are asymptomatic, but is there a possibility of any heart damage in them?
So children are a group that I don't routinely see. But the reason why we are expecting more youngsters to be affected as this wave stays on and progresses is because we are vaccinating all the adults first. So we feel the children, first of all, they are more difficult to control in schools and social gatherings, especially the little children. So their social distancing is an issue for them because kids will be kids, right? And that's what they love to do. They love to mingle, okay? And so they tend to get infections quickly. They tend to spread infections because of how they are. And the vast majority of them will recover with little or no symptoms from what we have seen. But there are a small group who can get sick. The exact extent of cardiac involvement in these children is not clearly documented. No, I don't think I have a clear thing of exactly what percentage of children have cardiac involvement.
What about the heart damage which is caused by COVID? Is it reversible or is it like permanent?
Okay, the vast majority of heart damage caused by COVID is reversible. Because when you have inflammation because of COVID and you have this myocardial inflammation, majority of it is fully reversible, and within 3 to 6 weeks, there's no evidence of them having anything. In a small percentage of patients, this can progress to a cardiomyopathy and lead to heart failure. In a very, very small percentage. So, and that is when it comes to myocarditis. But when it comes to having a heart attack, suppose you had a COVID-related heart attack, which I did tell you there's 1% chance you could have, the muscle damage from that will stay damaged. So it is irreversible. The key is to any symptom to not ignore. Don't take lightly.
What are those red alerts? Like supposing somebody is maybe like a week into COVID, they're either at home or at hospital. What are the heart-related red alerts that one must be aware of? How long should, when can you say that, okay, now I don't think I'm going to get any of these complications?
Okay, so I think you are safe if you've had a relatively mild attack after 30 days after your COVID infection. It's unlikely that the COVID is causing whatever it's caused for you. Coming back to what are the red alerts, unfortunately, the red alerts for heart disease are also some of the symptoms you have for COVID. Like any sudden increase in shortness of breath, any tightness of the chest, any chest discomfort, anything that's making you unwell on that day, I'd rather say you better be safe than sorry. Because the only reason you'd want to avoid going to a hospital and meeting a doctor is catching COVID. You've already caught COVID, so you're secure. Just go get yourself checked up.
Absolutely. So how do you cope with, you know, the other part of this whole COVID thing is the COVID fear, the phobia, the anxiety. And having spoken to several patients who were hospitalized, I think it is the fear of, you know, like, you know, getting complications, being in an environment, seeing other people going into the ICU or passing away. It does create a very, very severe impact on one's mental health. And we know that stress also contributes to heart disease. So what would your advice be to patients who have COVID-19 and who are wherever they are, at home or hospital? How should they, you know, like, you know, just not let the stress engulf them so much that that causes its own complications?
Well, one good way is not listen to specialists like me telling you of all the heart-related complications you can have from COVID. No, but jokes apart, right? These are tough times. As human beings, we crave for social integration. Okay, that's all we do. We thrive in social integration. Again, you know, in these blue zones, the single most important quality that they all had for them to reach 100 was people who had close friends, tightly knit communities, who knew their grocer, who knew their milkman. These are the people who live longer, right? What COVID has done is it has isolated all of us. And that is a precursor, is a cesspool for getting down, getting depressed. And we have to overcome it. My advice is 30 minutes a day, find something you love doing, like reading Amar Chitra Katha comic or reading an Asterix book or watching that soap on TV that you never had time to watch. When you have been quarantined or put together as a group, don't look at it as a forceful confinement, but look at it as a unique once-in-a-lifetime opportunity in the middle of your career to spend a retired life with your family, right? It's majority of life in poker, right? You can win with the worst hand dealt to you because you're not playing the cards, you're playing the player, right? So here again, it's all about how you perceive what's imposed on you. And I thoroughly enjoyed the 3 or 4 months of intense lockdown with the first wave because all I did is I spent so much time with Kritika, with Uda, with my family, and that was like rejuvenating. So one, now you have a lot of security in vaccines. Get everybody around you vaccinated, form a close group, and you can meet inside that close group. It's called pods. You can create a little bio bubble of your close family and friends and make sure you don't meet others. And I don't know if that's a good thing or bad thing, but stay in those bubbles, create spaces that give you happiness, surround yourself with people that you relax with, and that'll be tremendously useful for your mental health and relieving anxiety. Two, a little bit of information is good, but too much information is bad. So So I would say limit the amount of time you spend on digital and social media. You know, there's a rule at home for me that nobody in my family can come into the dinner room or the lunch room or the table when we sit and eat together with their handphones with them. It has to be left outside. Because when you have to bring your handphone either to an important meeting or when you want to sit and talk with family, instantly you're disrespecting the person you're with. You're giving more importance to a gadget than to the living, breathing person in front of you, right? And that is something that's very important, I feel. So spend time with people, cherish the people you have, do things you love, watch a movie, read a book, and stay happy.
Right. Before we go on to the several questions that are there coming to us real time, I just wanted to close by also asking you this about elderly people, because they are the ones who are vulnerable in a sense, probably also have some heart disease, some of them. Plus they live in intense fear of COVID. And some of them might have had, surgeries or it's really, they're terrified of getting COVID, or once they get it, that makes them very scared also. So what would you tell them? Like, do they really have to be so paranoid? Is it that, they just, as long as they are observing precautions, it's fine?
So I think they absolutely should be more. So there's a beautiful book written by ex-Intel CEO. It's called Only the Paranoid Survive. Okay. And once it comes to COVID and our elders, I feel they're a very precious part of our community, right? And whether you like it or not, they are more vulnerable than all of us. So it is, I would rather they be paranoid, stay isolated, mask, maintain social distancing, than let their guard down and get sick. Because the probability that they will get far sicker than us is higher. Point number one. Point number two, a good way they can stay sane. See, the toughest COVID has been, I think, is on our elders. Because what is the one thing that they cherish? Their independence, no? Their freedom. And that's taken away. Most of them are cooped up, isolated from everybody else. The one good thing that has happened is the vaccine will allow them to ease up a little, at least meet their children, their grandchildren who have been vaccinated. But I implore all the children and grandchildren of the elders you love, that please treat every interaction with them as it is something that you could infect them. Maintain your distance. Make sure you are healthy. The slightest symptoms, don't go close to them. Even if they are vaccinated, wear a mask, sit 6 feet away from them in a nicely ventilated room and spend time with them. And yes, the elders in our community should be more careful and should not let their vigil down.
Absolutely. So we'll now go to the questions that are coming to us. Sure. So I'll read them out one by one. Some of them we might have discussed earlier, but I'll anyway read them out.
Sure.
Should I exercise, lift weights post-COVID recovery? How will I know that my heart condition has been impacted?
So if you have had a mild, relatively mild COVID, so I'm a big fan of lifting weights and strength training, okay? And when people ask me why I exercise, different people have different reasons to exercise. Some people exercise to look good, some people exercise to fit. I exercise because I can indulge in all the things I love. Simple as that, right? Am I particularly fond of exercising? I wouldn't say I'm obsessively fond of it, but I still meticulously do it. I can't remember the last time where I haven't worked out at least 3 days a week, right? Now, so I'm a big fan of lifting weights. Now, it's extremely important that you give a good 1 month as a blanket rule before you hit the gym and start lifting weights post any COVID infection. Because lifting weights takes a lot out of you. It will, of course, be individual based, but as a golden rule for the public, since I don't know any of the specifics, for 1 month post-COVID, don't go to the gym, don't lift weights, just do cardio.
Will my BP or other parameters be different post-COVID? Will they ever return to normal?
Most definitely, they will return to normal. You can have some fluctuation post-COVID. Your BP can go a little lower, your BP can go a little higher, but that is life, right? I say, when people tell me, doctor, morning my BP is 120/80, evening my BP is 140/90, I say, that's proof of life, my dear, enjoy it. So things will fluctuate, your heart rate will change, your BP will change, you've had an infection, it will be up and down a little. The cutoffs don't change. If your blood pressure is over 150, over 90, 95, then see your doctor. If your blood pressure is less than 90 by 50, see your doctor. More importantly, don't just go by your blood pressure. If you're feeling ill and you're feeling tired and you're feeling listless, then go get yourself checked up. But 98% of you will all recover beautifully within a month of your COVID and be well.
Am I more susceptible to heart attacks post-COVID? I think we have already spoken.
Yes, you are. But a small percentage of you are, and depends on your other risk factors, which are compounded because of the COVID infection.
Will COVID asymptomatic patients with existing heart problems have any serious issues post-COVID?
It's unlikely. The very fact that you're asymptomatic means that your body has coped with the infection very, very well. And as a whole, you're better equipped to sail through it than people who have had a serious onslaught from the virus.
Should I get a heart health check done post-COVID?
If you do it too quickly, the reports will be off. So I suggest you don't do it too quickly. What I follow in my practice is any patient who's required hospitalization, I get an echo done, I get all their heart parameters checked. If you don't require hospitalization, I don't do anything specific for the heart until you come to me with a complaint. If you want to get yourself fully checked up because you feel you've had COVID and it will go a long way in reassuring you, which is what most of my patients, you know, because this is something that everybody asks me every day. Doctor, ippona COVID mudichan doctor, I want to do one proper checkup to make sure I'm all right. If it's going to give you peace of mind, just do it. You'll be pleasantly surprised. You'll sleep better.
My father, aged 68, is a diabetic and has had a bypass in 2019. Second dose of Covishield was taken in February 2021. In April, he took Remdesivir for normal COVID symptoms, but no steroids taken. Should he do any particular test to see whether his heart is okay?
So, from what I understand, diabetic, 2019 bypass, finished two doses of vaccine, then got COVID, which itself is very reassuring because you have finished two doses. Obviously, you had mild COVID. You have not told me whether he required how many days of hospitalization, whether he was in the ICU or no. So difficult for me to answer this very specifically.
He says normal COVID symptoms, so I assume that it's probably mild to moderate.
Mild to moderate. But he took Remdesivir, which means he was hospitalized.
Quite a mystery. Right?
Yeah. But still, I would say 3 months from his COVID, do a full checkup and then you'll rest easy. I don't think he has taken any damage to his heart as long as he hasn't had any symptoms so far.
After COVID recovery, my triglycerides have gone up. It's 320. Is it alarming?
320 is high. I don't know. You might have missed the fact that your triglycerides could have been higher before as well, or you have a familial tendency to have high triglycerides. The thing is that what would have kept your triglycerides in check is your activity level, which has been completely cut out by COVID. So just wait a month. If your triglycerides are still high, you can start your exercise and have your diet adjusted so that you bring your triglycerides down. And if that doesn't work, you might have to go on medication. You don't have to do it immediately, but you have to watch it. And in a 3 to 6 month period, if it's continuing to stay high, you'll have to address it.
For someone who's had no issues, no obesity, no diabetes, how long should one monitor their heart? Normally, we do only once a year.
Okay. So the worst person you can ask this is to a cardiologist. You know how when you go to a policeman, Srinidhi, he will see a thief in everybody because that's his sample. Every day he looks at crooks morning, evening and night. Every day I look at heart attacks. So I think everything is heart related. I check the people I love once in 6 months for the blood test. And I do a full checkup once a year, like the treadmill and the full hog is once a year. But I check for cholesterol, sugars on myself and all my loved ones once in 6 months. That's what I follow.
Right. I was infected with COVID on April 14th. Is there any possibility after 50 days now, will I get any heart-related issues? Please clear my doubt.
Extremely, extremely unlikely. As long as you're feeling well, I don't foresee you getting any sudden heart-related issues now. It's almost 2 months since your COVID. The chances are even slimmer than the sick patients. But he hasn't, has he mentioned whether he was hospitalized for COVID or no?
No.
No.
He just said he was infected.
Okay. Very unlikely. It's a simple answer.
For a tachycardia patient, what's the pulse rate that's fine?
Okay. Tachycardia is nothing but a fast heart rate, right? So I don't think there is a tachycardia patient. I think if your heart rate is beating fast, you can have two reasons why your heart rate beats fast. It can be physiological or it can be pathological. Physiological, we all have tachycardia. You know, when you're just walking into that exam hall when you're a child and you feel your heart pounding in your chest, that's physiological tachycardia. When you meet that one special person you love, your heart races, that's physiologic tachycardia. When you run up a flight of stairs, that's physiologic tachycardia. If your heart rate for no reason is always beating fast, it should be investigated. You should see if you have anemia. You should see if there's any rhythm abnormality. And you should consult your doctor and get to the bottom of it and make sure you don't have tachycardia.
Okay. I think that's about it. So I think we've reached the end of our session, and I think it's been lovely chatting with you, because I think there's been so many doubts about heart disease and with what people read and what people see on social media. This has been a real reassuring session where I hope that people will be aware that what they must do. For example, you did stress that elders must take care.
Absolutely.
Or people out for red alerts, so it's not just give up everything and it will go up in the air, but at the same time not to become stressed out and paranoid, but look at things in a more with perspective and in a rational way. I'm sure everybody has been really helped by this session. Thank you, Dr. Sai Satish, and thank you, viewers, for participating. Do watch out for our next session, which would be on the 11th of June, that is coming Friday, at the same time, which is 2 p.m. And the topic is going to be about recovering from COVID-19. And it's going to be a special episode on mental well-being, mental health. And this is going to be by Dr. Kirti Pai. Please subscribe also to our YouTube channel, because that has also all these live videos as well as the latest information on several healthcare topics. So check that out. If you have any more queries, yes, you can reach out to us on our Facebook page. Till then, till we meet again, please take care, stay safe, and recover well from COVID if you've had it. And the others, don't forget our SMS, which we discussed earlier, which is the social distancing, wearing the mask, and always using the sanitizer, soap and water, or sanitizer as often as possible. Stay safe. Thank you, and namaste.
Thank you all for having me here with you. Hope you all took something back from this.